शतारिणे नमो महावरण्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम्ने गौरत्विषे नमः। हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीन बंधो जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे। प्रपन्नः पारिजाताय तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। हरे कृष्णा। वेलकम ऑल डिवोटीज फॉर आवर डिस्कशन ऑन श्रीमद् भगवद गीता। वी आर डूइंग द स्टडी ऑफ द थर्ड चैप्टर ऑफ भगवद गीता एंड टुडे वी विल ट्राई एज मच एज पॉसिबल टू कंप्लीट इट अहेड। व्हाइल रीडिंग द स्क्रिप्चर्स especially the scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, it's very important that we see it from our personal life view, from the side of how it applies to me, not on how much it is to judge others or so. So we should always focus on how much far distant I am from the truth told in the scriptures, how much I should strive, where am I lacking, and strive in that direction to bring out transformation in one's own life, and then to use it to assess or analyze others' practice or behavior. So we are now studying the third chapter, that is Karma Yoga, which essentially is telling about how to perform the activities in this world in connection to the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna, in which we have very elaborately seen how not to harbor the selfish desires secretly, the desire to enjoy the results while externally showing as if we are above them. That was dealt very elaborately by Lord in the very first section, where Lord told, engage in karma yoga than jnana yoga. He told about the false renunciation, like that. And in the next section of third chapter, we saw that how even to address one's needs or necessities or desires, karma yoga is better. There we saw the karma kanda section from 10 to 15 or 16. And there it was clearly established that for everything we are dependent on Lord, even for food grains. And later we saw the next section, and that is starting from 17 onwards, where there was discussion about even if one doesn't have desires in the heart, one should still perform one's duties. And there was a higher purpose given there. What was the purpose given?
Anyone because recollect? Common men will follow self-realized person's activities.
Yes, so correct. So people usually take the examples of what the leaders do. So to set proper standards, to set proper example for the general mass of people, one should perform duties. Even if one is qualified for, Krishna is telling, even if one's heart is freed from desires, still one self-realized soul performs duties. It doesn't show an example of renunciation very commonly, because people are not purified in general. And if they take the example of renunciation, not able to keep up that living, they may cause disturbance in the society. They may take to false practices, malpractices, and that will cause so much of destruction of faith for innocent. So that's why it is advised highly to set an example for proper duties than example for renunciation. That was seen. And then we also saw from 25th onwards, what was the next section about the two types of workers we saw? Any of you recollect? Two types of workers.
Sakta.
There was
Asakta.
Sakta and Asakta. Very good. Very nice that you recollected, Prabhu. So Sakta and Asakta, that is attached and detached worker. In one sense, attached worker you can call Karma Kandi, and detached worker Karma Yogi. In usually in Bhagavad Gita, when the word of Karma Yoga is mentioned by Lord or by Prabhupada in the purports, it usually refers to Nishkama Karma Yoga. So attached worker and detached worker, that difference was dealt. And how a detached worker, that is Nishkama Karma Yogi, deals with someone who is attached in this world, Karma Kandi, that also was dealt. So to just review that, revise that, there was this discussion between attached and detached worker. I just got this table from Gauranga Priya Prabhu's guidebook. I thought to just put it as a summary. So there were several things discussed in 27 and 28. They are the two shlokas. 27th is Prakrite Kriyamanani Gunai Karmani Sarvasha, very famous words. Ahankara Vimudhatma Kartaham Iti Manyate, wherein the discussion about attached worker was given. How a person of this world thinks, that is, he first of all desires gratification for oneself, and he thinks he is the doer. Kartaham Iti Manyate. And what is his knowledge of identity? What does he think himself as? He doesn't understand that he is different from the body. He thinks this body is just obtained by me. It's me. I have to utilize it. I have to engage in sense gratification. He doesn't know that it's provided by Prakriti. It's happening. All the activities are happening by the gunas of Prakriti. Prakriti Kriyamanani Gunai Karmani Sarvashah. He doesn't realize that. All the activities are happening by the Prakriti, through the gunas, all that. And he surely will not acknowledge the presence of Supreme Lord in here. On the other side, Nishkama Karma Yogi, he knows his awkward position. That was discussed in shloka number 28. Tattva Vittu Mahabaho Gunakarma Vibhagayo Guna Guneshu Vartanta Iti Matva Na Sachyate. He knows that what is the position of his in this world. And he understands his original position, that is spiritual position in association of Lord. And knowing that, he strives in Krishna consciousness. Everything he knows, whatever is happening in the world through him is actually happening by the mercy of Lord. He is not the independent actor. In fact, the Lord is making it happen. He is sanctioning, he is approving, he is in fact making it happen. What the jiva is doing is just an insignificant desire. That's the only part which the jiva is doing. So these are the very clear distinguishing traits of attached and detached worker, which Lord described in 27 and 28. And how a detached worker should deal with attached worker, can anyone recollect? There were two verses about it. When a bhakta, he sees someone who is very much attached and following some form of Vedic practice, some form of religion. How do we deal?
Don't bewilder him. Don't quickly change him too quickly. He will get shocked and let him do it and then slowly convert him into.
Okay. Prabhu is telling to not disturb him. The word was used, na vichalayet. Do not unsettle them. 39 number shloka says that do not agitate them. There was that word also used, huh? Na buddhi bhedam janaye, do not disrupt his intelligence too much, huh? At least he is following something which will gradually bring him to Krishna consciousness, huh? The devotee knows this and he strengthens that faith, and wherever possible, how much ever extent the person is able to accept, he joins Krishna element there. He adds Krishna element there. That is very important. And Prabhupada told also in that purport that this is 26. Yeah. The learned Krishna conscious person may act in such a way that the ignorant person working for sense gratification may learn how to act and how to behave. So devotees, they just by their very actions of performing duties, they teach the world in general how to act and how to behave. More things are seen and caught than taught, is it not? They say it very famously. The actions speak so loud that we can't hear your words, people say. So there are so many like that, that the behavior is very closely observed. That is true. Yeah. So now let's go ahead. We had stopped in 29. Am I right? We had stopped in 29. Yeah, in my knowledge, that was the last one. So today we are going to number 30. So now after Lord has described Nishkama Karma Yoga, the distinguishing position of Nishkama Karma Yoga compared to Karma Kanda, now he tells one very important higher purpose for a Nishkama Karma Yogi. That is to sacrifice results, knowing to whom it should be actually be offered to. That is Supreme Lord. And here he tells, Lord says, you offer it to me. He says the word me. The very first time he's doing this in third chapter. You know, so even when the shloka came about offering the yajna to Lord, yajnartat karmano nyatra lokoyam karma bandhana, there he meant you offer it to yajna or Vishnu. He did not say me. But now here in third chapter, first time he uses the word me, in Sanskrit mayi. So that's the 30th shloka. Who would be reading the translations today?
Shall I read, Prabhu? Prabhuji?
Okay. Yes, yes, Mataji, you can read. We will recite the shloka together.
Okay.
Mayi sarvani karmani sanyasyatma chetasa nirashir mamubha yudhyasva vikata jvaraha.
Therefore, O Arjuna, surrendering all your works unto me with full knowledge of me, without desires for profit, with no claims to proprietorship, and free from lethargy, fight.
Yeah. Thank you. So this shloka is one of the very key shlokas in third chapter about the essence of Karma Yoga, how Karma Yoga should be performed. It is told here. Some of the acharyas have told that this is called as Karma Sara. There is one Karma Sara comes in 11th chapter also. And this is also called Karma Sara. Like there are famous verses in Bhagavad Gita called Charama Shloki, Chatushloki, Tri Shloki, Vedanta Sara, Gita Rahasya. These are one verses are titled like this. There are special verses in Bhagavad Gita. This one, 3.30, some of the acharyas have told it's Karma Sara. Means how to perform work in this world. That way it is very famous. Mayi sarvani karmani. Offer all the results to me, O Arjuna. Offer all the karmani means offer the results of the activities. Offer, in fact, the activity you do it for my purpose. Sanyasya means you offer it to me. Adhyatma chetasa. Do it with the full knowledge of me. Adhyatma chetas. With the full consciousness of me, then he qualifies. Nirashi, no desires for oneself. Nirmama, can you someone tell what is nirmama?
Nirmama. Ownership.
yeah, not claiming any ownership or proprietorship. Oh, this belongs to me. No. Mama means this belongs to me. Near mama means no, not claiming that. Near mama. And then he says, Vigata Jwara Yudhyas. Freeing from all lethargy fight. So Prabhupada explains these one words very nicely in the purport. When we read the purport, usually we should make an attempt to correlate what words of the shloka are being referred in what section of the purport. That's a very good way to understand how the purport is flowing. So usually Prabhupada does that very nicely. So in the very first part, Prabhupada says that this is a nice purport. We should read this purport. Mataji, read the purport on the screen.
This purport. This verse clearly indicates the purpose of the Bhagavad Gita. The Lord instructs that one has to become fully Krishna conscious to discharge duties as if in a military discipline. Such an injunction may make things a little difficult. Nevertheless, duties must be carried out with dependence on Krishna because that is the constitutional position of the living entity. The living entity cannot be happy independent of the living entity cannot be happy independent of the cooperation of the Supreme Lord, because the eternal constitution position of the living entity is to become subordinate to the desires of the Lord. Arjuna was therefore ordered by Sri Krishna to fight as if the Lord were his military commander. One has to sacrifice everything for the goodwill of the Supreme Lord and at the same time discharge prescribed duties without claiming proprietorship.
Okay, Arjuna, just a minute. Okay. Which word of the shloka is being talked? Or words?
Karmani, activities all
there. Mayi sarvani karmani. You can see that Lord tells here, Arjuna did not have to consider, he just has to execute. Don't think, all that you leave it to me, sannyasya. Just perform the work. That Lord Prabhupada is telling here, military discipline. This is very important. This verse is famous for this word, military discipline. Did you notice that in the very beginning part it came? Why military discipline? It's very interesting. Because one who is in the military, he just follows the order of the someone who is above him. He may not really understand why this order is given. Sometimes in a regiment, there is a leader of the regiment, means a group of soldiers who is deployed for certain task. So that person, individual soldier, he may not understand why order is given. Why are we not attacking now? Why are we taking delay? Why are we taking this strategic position? This, that, he may not understand. But what is told to him, what is trained for him, is to follow the order of the leader of the regiment. So that is very important for one who is in the army or in the regiment, military. So Prabhupada is telling, just as in a military discipline, one should execute Krishna consciousness. One may not make sense of why this rule, why that regulation. Sometimes even with our intelligence, there are so many wonderful explanations why it is good for us, but still sometimes our intelligence may justify other way, it may tell something else. Still, putting aside our very nice mature intelligence in the side, follow the orders of Guru, Sadhu and Shastra, that's military discipline. So Arjuna did not have to consider the order, he did not have to think, analyze. Krishna told, let's follow it. Like that. So that is the higher purpose. That's the Mayi Sarvani Karmani part, Sanyasya. Now from here, Lord will tell also about Adhyatma Chetasa, conscious, fully Krishna conscious. And of course, it will come next words. So as you read, try to see which word is being taught. By that way, we also memorize the shloka and the purport also becomes very nicely understood, by us. Please read ahead. Yeah.
Have I to continue, Prabhuji?
Or? Yeah, from where, you please read, Mataji, from where we left off. Yeah. Adhyatma Cheta.
Arjuna did not have to consider the order of the Lord. He had only to execute his order. The Supreme Lord is the soul of all souls. Therefore, one who depends solely and wholly on the Supreme Soul without personal consideration, or in other words, one who is fully Krishna conscious, is called Adhyatma Chetas. Nirasi means that one has to act on the order of the master, but should not expect fruitative results. The cashier may count millions of dollars for his employer, but he does not claim a cent for himself. Similarly, one has to realize that nothing in the world belongs to any individual person, but that everything belongs to the Supreme Lord. That is the real purpose of Mayi, or unto me. And when one acts in such Krishna consciousness, certainly he does not claim proprietorship over anything. Shall this I continue? Conscious.
Yeah, continue.
This consciousness is called Nirmama, or nothing is mine. And if there is any reluctance to execute such a stern order, which is without consideration of so-called kinsmen in the bodily relationship, that reluctance should be thrown off. In this way, one may become Vigata Jvara, or without feverish mentality or lethargy. Everyone, according to his quality and position, has a particular type of work to discharge. And all such duties may be discharged in Krishna consciousness as described above. That will lead one to the path of liberation.
Thank you. So let us quickly check the shloka. Very important shloka to understand. There is first, Mayi Sarvani Karmani Sanyasya. Means you offer the all the, you know, you don't worry about the karma. You just perform it as an order of the Lord, because it is given by the Lord. And leave all the results, all the worries about the work to the Lord. Just perform the activity ordered by the Lord. Mayi Sarvani Karmani Sanyasya. Adhyatma Chetasa. You be consciousness, you fix it in me, Krishna conscious. Adhyatma Chetasa. Nirashi. No desires for oneself. Means no, do not desire the results for oneself. Nirmama, do not claim things for yourself. The belongings, this is mine, that is mine. So Prabhupada gave a nice example in this regard. Very practical example. Anyone could recollect, what's the example which Prabhupada told in
cashier
this?
Cashier example, Prabhuji. The cashier example, Prabhuji. Yeah.
Yes, cashier. Very nice. Cashier is counting so much of the money in the bank. But he cannot claim a penny or a rupee for himself, nor can he desire that also. Even if he desires, he cannot surely take it. Is it not? So the point is that kind of, understanding that the Lord is a proprietor. I cannot desire this for myself. And finally, when there is so much of, impositions, you do not worry, you do not desire for oneself, be in the consciousness of Lord, then naturally there is some laziness which comes to work. what is there for me in this? One will not be inspired in a conditioned state. Lord says that, Vigata Jvara Yudhyasva, leave aside your laziness and follow the order. So Lord has told all round instruction here in that sense. So this is a very important shloka. Prabhupada told the last line of the purport. I read it again. It's interesting to reflect. Everyone according to his quality and position. According to his quality and position has a particular type of duty to discharge, work to discharge. And all such duties may be discharged in Krishna consciousness as described above. What it means is, according to the position and quality, guna and karma and the guna, there is some particular dharma which is associated with that position, varna, shrama, or certain types of different types of dharmas within that, the broad varna and ashrama. So one should perform those duties in Krishna consciousness. One need not strive to perform something which is extraneous or which is not his guna and karma. One should align that guna and karma in Krishna consciousness. That will lead one to the path of liberation. This is very essential instruction, because this will come little later. I'm just giving a brief here, because this will come later, about this guna, karma, dharma, one's swadharma, you know, all that will come little ahead. So this is an important part to note. So my Lord is telling, he's giving the order, he's surely giving the order according to one's varna and ashrama. Kshatriyas, Arjuna is given the order, you fight. So why he has to do something which is not his varna or ashrama, that is leave and go to the forest. Yeah. So Arjuna is told, you do it in Krishna consciousness, like that. Okay. So any comment or question?
Yes, Prabhuji, I have one point or question to discuss. See, here we are talking about detachment or something like that, because the cashier example, okay, if a robber comes to the bank, okay, he asks to give the complete cash, okay, he just give it up, okay, because that cash doesn't belong to him, okay, so he will not have any emotional attachment. But practically, we talk about a lot of ownership, okay, and versus detachment. I really struggle to balance these two. Okay, where do you let go? Where do you take the ownership of it? And the sloka meaning is easy, but the practical application is very, very challenging. That's what I personally feel. This concept of ownership. Itself, like, he will not have any feeling. He doesn't have any sleepless nights. Okay, if a thief comes in the bank and he hand over the entire cash.
Yes. So the example is for the purpose to show that we cannot claim, we cannot say that though we are using that, you know, the cashier is counting the money, he cannot claim it to be his. So similarly, a karma yogi who is practicing in this, who is working in this world, he may, you know, receive something, he may use something, but he should know very clearly whom it belongs to. That is the example's scope. Now, taking it one step ahead, as you told, now for a devotee, bhakti yogi, when he is utilizing things in service of Krishna, he wants to continue consistently offering that quality of service to Krishna. He doesn't want to degrade from that quality of service, for which he wants to also see that things are well maintained for the service of Krishna. So this question has to be very honestly asked within, that am I doing this for the service of Krishna, or am I doing it for my own happiness or my own satisfaction? And that honesty is something which is very personal. You know, we cannot legislate or, you know, bring it to the terms of external. So like Srila Prabhupada was asked, you know, suppose if someone attacks you, some criminal attacks you, what will you do? Prabhupada told, I'll surely fight to protect myself. Yes. Now you may say, how a devotee is, you know, so selfish to protect his body. No, anyway, the body is temporary, or body doesn't belong to him. No, but the body is a medium to do service to Krishna. Similarly, the assets to be used for service to Krishna. So Prabhupada fought such long legal battles, fighting for the properties. So many examples we see in the lives of great devotees, great, great sannyasis who worked hard to do some, some magnificent temples, services for the future of generation to take benefit of. So that question is very, has to be honest, you know, in within, and one should assess by that. And okay, surely the guru, if one is in the association of guru, then there is a lot of such purification can happen, you know, that is also there.
Understood. So in nutshell, like, the answer is something like that. If I am doing it to some extent to myself, then you feel bad. So if you're doing everything for Krishna, so there is no question of feeling bad. Okay. Even if something happens. So it's like a twofold answer. Yeah, that's what you're trying to explain.
And in and when we are doing it for pleasure of Krishna, then there is naturally self-protection taken care. That is also the higher understanding. Because Krishna wants us to render the service happily in a good frame of mind. And he is also a very sentient person, is it not? He himself is assuring that, you know, yoga kshemam vaham yaham. You know, Lord is telling this in the 9th chapter where pure devotional service is talked about. So he is assuring that. So when a devotee offers such a, you know, unconditional service to Lord, Lord responds bountifully. You know, he is so much magnanimous. He takes care of everything which the jiva leaves aside for Lord. You know, so in that sense, the devotee knows that Lord is there to protect me. I don't need to worry. You know, that's the bhakti yogi understanding also. Is that okay?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you.
So now, from text 31 onwards, what's coming here is, so in the shloka number 30, there was a very important principle of karma yoga which was explained. That is to work in consciousness of Lord, adhyatma chetasa, and offer it all the activities for Lord. Mayi sarvani karmani. So the word mayi was used. Lord told very clearly that you do it for me. In the second chapter also, he had told, mat para. He had told, you know, you fix your consciousness in me. That was the only verse in second chapter. In third chapter also, now it is coming. So there are glimpses of bhakti, you know, in the first 6 chapters. They are nonetheless there. We cannot say that they are not there. So there was a higher purpose of karma yoga, nishkama karma yoga, told by the Lord here. Now in going the shlokas next, he tells, what is the result of performing the activities in that manner? Performing the activities or attitudes in the activities in that manner. That is text number 31. Let's read that. Ye me matamidam nityam anutishpanti manava radhavanto nusyanto mucyante tepi karmabhi. Please read.
Those persons who execute their duties according to my injunctions and who follow this teaching faithfully without envy become free from the bondage of fruitive actions.
So executing these duties according to my injunctions. What injunctions? Lord told now so far from 17 up till 30. You know, he told very nicely about the karma yoga, nishkama karma yoga. These injunctions, one who follows like this, in two essential manner, shraddhavanto anasuya, with faith and with non-enviousness. Very important qualities for a practicing sadhaka devotee. Shraddhavanto anasuyanto. What will happen to him? Muchyante. He will attain liberation, free from bondage of fruitive actions, which is actually the goal of karma yoga. Nishkama karma yogi, he wants to be relieved from the bondage. So now, Prabhupada takes this point and faithfully and without envy. And he explains it in the purport. One should have firm faith in this injunction without envying the Lord. There are so-called commentators of Bhagavad Gita who don't have faith in Krishna. So they will never be liberated, because they don't have faith in Krishna. They don't accept Krishna's position. And they don't have faith in the words of Krishna. Really? Is it so that Krishna will, you know, if I offer everything for Krishna's purpose without desiring nirashi, nirmama, and if I strive like this, then I will be protected, I will be taken care, I will not get lost. They doubt like that. So they will never be liberated. Such a doubtful man. No, they say that, you know, doubting Thomas, you know, doubts actually hold one back. And doubt is, okay, before getting the proper knowledge, if one is having doubts, that is okay because there is lack of knowledge. But after receiving knowledge, if one still has doubts, that means he is having a misgiving, means he doesn't trust the source of knowledge. So there is a deeper misgiving. That's called misgiving. So the point is, one should have that faith in the Lord's instructions. They will never be liberated if one doesn't have. But an ordinary man, this is very interesting per line. I'm reading this. I'm highlighting that. But an ordinary man with firm faith in the injunctions, eternal injunctions of the Lord, even though unable to execute such orders, please note, even though unable to execute such orders, he becomes liberated from bondage of law of karma. In the beginning of Krishna consciousness, one may not fully discharge the injunctions of the Lord. Whatever Lord has told, we are aware, but we are not able to discharge. We know that, okay, I'm not able to practice. But because one is not resentful, someone could mute and there is some echo. Because one is not resentful of this principle and works sincerely without consideration of defeat and hopelessness, he will surely be promoted to the stage of pure Krishna consciousness. Very interesting. Even though one is not able to follow the injunctions, but if one has that faith on those injunctions, and he endeavors sincerely whatever is possible, then Lord will award the result of proper following of injunctions, because one has that faith. So there is this word here used called resentful. Can someone tell what is resentful? What does it mean, resent? Resent, R-E-S-E-N-T.
To be unhappy.
To be unhappy, okay. Okay. Anything more to describe that?
Which word you said?
Bitterness. Something
resent. Like bitterness. Bitter feeling, yeah, you're bitter right. Feeling. Yes, I was looking for that. Bitter.
Bitter.
Being bitter remorseful.
Remorse is different, resent.
Not remorseful, okay, yeah.
Remorse is like paschat, you know, paschatap kind of thing. Remorse. Resent, yeah. Yes, as one of the devotees told, bitter feeling, something like anger or, you know, envy. You know, you kind of don't accept that instruction in the heart. You doubt that instruction. You don't want that instruction. It's bitter for you. You know, you see, one thing is, okay, I'm not able to practice devotional service. The pure devotional service as described in the Bhagavatam, in the Bhagavad Gita, just now Lord told in 3.30. So, okay. Now, to say that, this, you keep it aside, this is something which is not possible, this is something which will not work. You know, to have this attitude towards the instructions, that is resent.
So tell, is it against the, not accepting, Prabhuji? Not accepting the...
Yes. So one doesn't accept in the heart. One says, one doubts that instruction and one discards that instruction. You know? So that is resent, which is not favorable, which is not healthy attitude. So one, you know that famous pastime in Ramanuja's Acharya's Leela, that lady, the wife of Dhanurdas, there was that one famous pastime which comes where Lord Ramanujacharya wants to show that how Dhanurdas is so elevated spiritually against his Matha's inmates, sannyasis, who are proud and who are telling why Ramanujacharya is giving so much time and attention to a householder like Dhanurdas. So then Ramanujacharya wants to prove it. So one day he goes, he tells one of them, or he himself does it. He goes and tears apart the cloths, the cowpens of the sannyasis in the matha. But they, and he displaces here and there and things like that. Next day morning, they are so disturbed. They are so disturbed. And then secretly, there is a part there. I'm not recollecting the proper past, wherein they go to take away the jewelry of the wife of Dhanurdas. Any of you know the past? Any of you? Ramanujacharya himself tells them, now you go and take away the jewelry of Dhanurdas's wife. So they go. So when they go, she is pretending to sleep. And she is letting the jewelry to be taken. And she knows that these people have come and they want to take. In the heart of hearts, she is thinking, are actually everything what I have is actually gurus. You know, and these are sannyasis, these are great mathas, residents who have come to take something. In fact, they are far more elevated. They are practicing so wonderfully, which I am not able to do. So she lets go everything. And later, Dhanurdas, when he comes, he's told about this by his wife. Then he says, oh, really? Then actually she says, seems like the matha is in need of some wealth. Maybe we should give. Just see the consciousness of these wonderful devotees. Then he was telling, why did not you give the wealth when they came? I still see you with some gold jewelry on your body. Then she told, actually, I wanted to give. As soon as I turned other side to let them take, they became fearful and they ran away. And there she tells that actually these people are practicing so nicely. We are not able to practice, but they are doing it so wonderfully. And anyway, whatever we have is property of Guru only. So, and then of course, Ramanujacharya calls those sannyasis and then he shows them, just see, you were fighting for your piece of cloth, but this wonderful householders, family men, they are so absorbed in serving me. Whatever they have in their care, they consider that it belongs to me and they want to give it you know, fully. So the point I told this was, the wife of Dhanurdas, she praises, she doesn't have any mood of resentment. She says that in fact, they are rendering good devotional service. So this attitude is very healthy, that one has faith, one doesn't envy, and one tries to sincerely execute. Prabhupada here mentioned that part also. Sincerely, without consideration of defeat and hopelessness. Then he will surely be promoted to the pure stage of Krishna consciousness, like that. Very hope-giving. At the same time, very introspective also. Yeah. Any of you want to comment or add anything?
To what extent you have progressed to or completed the Guru's order is secondary, but like how much faith you have, how much effort you are putting, that is going to be the key, Prabhuji.
The outcome of how much we are able to follow is actually determined by Lord, you know, determined by many factors around, because not only we are the doers, there are so many factors in the external world. But how is my endeavor? How is my faith, my sincerity? That is key, you know, in that sense.
Got it.
Take it. Now, on the other side, if one does not follow the injunction, so what happened here was that if one follows properly, what will be given to him? If one does karma yoga as per Lord's injunctions, what will happen to him? The positive result?
He will be purified.
Be free from material bondage.
He will be freed from bondage. Yes, surely he will be purified. He will be freed from bondage. Now, the shloka, next one is telling the negative result. Always the Shastra talks like this. It tells a principle. It tells the positive result. What will happen if you do it? It tells negative result. What will happen if you don't do it? Like, you know, Isha Upanishad also talks about it. Many places the things are explained like this. So that's called Anvaya and Vyatireka. Anvaya means positive result. Vyatireka means negative result. So what will be the negative result if one doesn't follow? Etvetat abhyasu yanto anutishtanti me matam sarvagnana vimudham stan vidhi nashtan achetasaha.
Translation. But those who, out of envy, disregard these teachings and do not follow them regularly, or to be considered bereft of all knowledge, befooled and ruined in their endeavors for perfection. Hare Krishna.
So negatively, if one does not follow, if one does not respect the injunctions or the teachings, what will happen? He will be bereft of all knowledge. The word is sarva gnana vimudha. He will be befooled, vimudha. You know, he will lose all the gnana. He will become mudha. That means he will be befooled and nashtan achetasaha. He will ruin all his endeavor. Nashta achetasa. He will lose Krishna consciousness. So that's the flaw of not being Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada tells that word in the purport. And disobedient person, however great he may be, is ignorant of his own self and of the absolute truth. So there is no hope of perfection for him like that. So this was explained. Now, let's quickly check where are we in the sections so that we keep track. So we are, just see, we completed the Karma Yoga, Karma Kanda difference, attached, detached worker. Now what we are seeing is how Karma Yoga is elevating. So in the 30th, Lord told the important principle of Karma Yoga, that he is the object of detachment. He is the object of offering the results, performing the action, everything. What will happen if one does? What will happen if one doesn't do? That was explained. Now next, in the elevation, explaining how Karma Yoga works or elevates, Lord will tell about very important aspect called prakriti, working according to one's prakriti or svabhava. So Karma Yoga, which is connecting to the Lord by one's actions, it has a great emphasis on working according to one's svabhava or prakriti, which is called svadharma. So what is this? That will be described from 32 on 33 onwards. Let us read them and discuss the course. Sadrisham cheshtate svasya prakriti prakritim yanti bhutani nigraham kim parishyati.
Even a man of knowledge acts according to his own nature. For everyone follows the nature he has acquired from the three modes. What can repression accomplish?
So everyone in this world acts according to his nature. His prakriti. See, the shloka says, let's see the shloka. Prakriter. Prakritim yanti. So two times it's used. So prakriti means nature, which means gunas. Prakriti means the gunas are involved in that. So what is one's nature, the gunas, that is going to matter on how he acts, what actions he performs. And though that nature cannot be artificially, cannot be restrained, nigraha, cannot be curtailed. What's the word used? Repression. Repression means forceful stopping of them or curbing them or, you know, putting them not to work or not to act. Repression. So what can repression accomplish? Your forceful disengagement will not work. By nature, you are a Kshatriya. You have the psychophysical natures to fight as a Kshatriya. If you forcefully disengage, do not play the role of Kshatriya, that will not go long. It will come out at one time or other. That is the essential key point here. Nigraha kim karishyati. Now here, an important point we have to understand. There are two things in a person's personality. There is one called prakriti or svabhava, which I earlier told. And there is something called vasana. No? Have you heard this word called vasanas? Previous vasanas, you know. Can someone tell what you understand by this word vasana?
Yes, Prabhuji. Vasana in the sense that this life, the memories which are there in deep consciousness, some kind of habits, it could be good or bad, which could be there, which you got them in this birth or in the previous birth.
Literally speaking, at least I can tell the language which I was, I spoke from my beginning of life. Vasana means smell. Is it so in Telugu?
Yes.
Yeah. In Kannada also vasana. It is
there. Kannada also it's there, yeah. So vasana means smell. Huh? So suppose you have a bottle, you had put something inside, you throw it out and you can still smell. Vasana is there, curd or, you know, say something item, you know, vasana is. So one may have performed an action and with his senses, there was an experience for the senses when it came in touch with sense object. So that experience stays in the subconscious mind. That is vasana. So vasanas are different and prakriti or swabhava is different. This distinguishment is important to make. We should not confuse. Now here, when Lord is telling what can repression accomplish, this does not mean whatever comes, you know, whatever comes in our subconscious mind or mind desires is all something which I should not forcefully control. I should not repress. Repress means stop, you know, control it. So let it be, you know, whatever way I feel, whatever sentiments, you know, anger, envy, lust, greed, these are not to be controlled. Is it like that? No. That's not the intent here. The intent here is, as we were talking earlier, Swadharma, there was a concept of Swadharma which had come in second chapter. So there is something called psychophysical nature. You know, the nature, one when we talked about here, Prakriti, it is psychophysical nature. It is very innate to one's existence in the material body he is in. Gross and subtle both. And there are certain, samskaras, which are very difficult to change quickly unless one is fully purified. What one should do is harmonize it with Krishna consciousness. That's easily harmonizable. And that's why Varnashrama is given, to engage according to one's prakriti or swabhava in the service of Lord. This is Varnashrama, actually, to say, very essentially. Now, vasana is something which cannot be harmonized in service of Lord. Say, lust, anger, greed. These are some things which have to be controlled, which have to be given up. That's why Lord will later, in the same chapter, little later, he will explain about controlling and lust. That's a very essential part of third chapter, which is going to come. So some people, there was one famous so-called spiritual leader who took this as the essence of Bhagavad Gita. Can you imagine what people can take? And he propagated telling, do not restrain your senses. Enjoy it. Let it come in touch with sense object and enjoy. That became very famous, so-called spiritual movement. Yeah, it's like that. So people can pick up anything and everything, you know, out of context. So here, what is told here is a psychophysical nature, which is very essential nature being in the material world, which carries across the bodies or lifetimes, and it could be harmonizable. So Prabhupada tells in the purport, you can say that there are many so-called spiritualists who outwardly pose as advanced in science, but inwardly or privately are completely under particular modes of nature, and they are unable to surpass. Academically, one may be very learned, but because of his long association with material nature, he is in bondage. But Krishna consciousness helps one to get out of that entanglement, even though one may be engaged in his prescribed duties. How? Without being fully in Krishna consciousness, one should not give up his occupational duties. So Lord is essentially telling that you engage in your swadharma according to swabhava. So there is swabhava, and swadharma is given according to that. Engage in that, oh Arjuna, do not leave it. That repression will not help you in any way. No one should suddenly give up his prescribed duties and become a so-called yogi or transcendentalist artificially. It is better to be situated in one's Varnashrama position and try to attain Krishna consciousness under superior training. Okay. Now here, I would also like to talk about how in devotional service, in our current day-to-day practice, we see this. So as we were talking, that there is everyone is having a particular type of swabhava. In the earlier Vedic times, this was very clearly observed right from the very early age, because of a very pure living, proper following of samskaras by parents, by the families, lineages like that. When the child was sent to the Gurukula in the very beginning, and that time itself, the guru, after a few years, the Guru Mata especially, she could find what is the swabhava of this child. And she would tell, this should be the way the future child should be engaged. He should work, or he should be cultivated like this, like that. That was never according to the birth. Surely Prabhupada tells it many times. So that was the way earlier. At the same time, when we see current day and age, it's very difficult. It's very, very difficult to understand what is one's swabhava. After sometimes, maybe more than half of one's life, one understands what is one's swabhava, wherein one has already passed so much of the life. And it is also mixed in the current day and age. One cannot say this his swabhava is more Brahminical or Vaishya or Kshatriya, or, you know, he looks like, you know, he's more, he should go in this direction, that direction, you know, Grihastha, Brahmachari, many, many like this. There are many conflicts which one may land up. The point is, one should practice Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada emphasizes here, practicing Krishna consciousness. By the very nature of practice of Krishna consciousness, one comes to goodness. And as one practices Krishna consciousness steadily, this swabhava dawns on that person after some level of practice. It also requires some superior guidance, observation, and honest introspection that will help one. But it takes time. It is never sudden, you know, because most, at least I can say, I have taken to Krishna consciousness much later in the year, you know, life. So it takes time to understand one's very natures. So that's the point. So in Krishna consciousness, when we are practicing, what we should emphasize? We should emphasize that as a bhakti yogi, I follow the orders of Guru. And Guru usually gives the orders according to one's swabhava. That's the original way it was, you know, instructions. Nonetheless, whether it's fitting to my swabhava or not, the following of order of Guru is very important. And by that following of order of Guru, one will receive the mercy. In the bhakti yoga, what is more stressed is following the orders of Guru than acting according to one's swabhava. Acting according to one's swabhava is an element of karma yoga. But nonetheless, for a steady, sustenance practice, one would need to engage according to one's nature. So as much as possible, how much ever what one could find one's nature, engage it in Krishna consciousness. But the most emphasis is on practicing Krishna consciousness. And that will naturally uncover that personal aspect, you know. So that is essentially there. So in these purports, what Lord is stressing, he's not stressing bhakti yoga fully here. He is stressing karma yoga, nishkama karma yoga. And he's telling Arjuna, you should not act against your nature. Act according to your nature of being a kshatriya. That's your swabhava. Do not restrain it. Act according to it. Do not take to someone else's duties, thinking that is your swabhava. Do not try to become a sannyasi or a brahmana. You are a kshatriya. You are a householder. Do that duties properly. That's the essential instruction or the thrust which will come in the next three shlokas till 35. Yeah. So we will quickly go over this translation and purport, and I will take the questions afterward. If anything is not answered or something, we will see the purports also. Maybe something gets answered in the course. Okay. So we are now reading 34. इंद्रियस्येन्द्रियस्यार्थे रागद्वेषौ व्यवस्थितौ तयोर्न वशमागच्छेत् सौख्यस्य परिपन्थिनौ.
Translation. There are principles to regulate attachment and aversion pertaining to the senses and their objects. One should not come under the control of such attachment and aversion, because they are stumbling blocks on the path of self-realization. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. So when engaging the Swabhava, one should guard against attachment and aversion. Krishna is telling, regulate the attachment and aversion. See, attachment and aversion are opposites, but nonetheless, the principle is self. The center is the self. You know, I like it, attachment. I don't like it, aversion. I like, say, you know, pav bhaji. I don't like, you know, say, some dosa. You know? So this is attachment and aversion. Why? Because I am the center. So there is a principle to regulate. Okay, I will offer. I will accept prasadam, either dosa or either vada pav, whatever it is. But it should be prasadam. So there is a principle of regulation. So that is essential in engaging one's swabhava. So one should not come under the control of those attachments and aversions. So there are rules and regulations given in the practice of this karma yoga, essentially even in bhakti yoga. And that rules and regulations should be practiced with keeping the purpose in mind. You know, it should not become niyamagraha. You remember nectar of instruction? Niyamagraha or niyamagraha. You know, don't follow the niyamas or follow it, you know, fanatically to the extent that you forget the purpose of it. So none of them should happen. Neither of them should happen. So what should happen is follow the niyamas with the purpose in mind very clearly. So Prabhupada tells, very interesting, he takes an example of what could be the attachment or aversion. So he takes, unrestricted sense enjoyment is the cause of material engagement. But one who follows rules and regulations of revealed scripture does not become entangled by sense objects. That's the principle. And for example, he takes one example. What's the example? He takes the example of sex enjoyment. So that could be a desire, a necessity for some, for which there is a rule and regulation given. So Prabhupada says here, you see, sex enjoyment is a necessity for the conditioned soul. Necessity, what is the mood behind using this word is the mind may want it because of the samskaras, many things like that. So sex enjoyment is a necessity for the conditioned soul, and sex enjoyment is allowed under the terms of marriage. So according to the scriptural injunctions, how one should deal in one's family life is explained. But little below, you can see, as long as material body is there, the necessities of material body are allowed. Don't know whether found it. Yeah, here. As long as the body is there, the necessities of body are allowed, but under rules and regulation. And yet, we should not rely on the control of such allowances. One has to follow the rules and regulations unattached to them. Because practice of sense gratification under regulations will also lead one to go astray. A very striking, Prabhupada is warning here. He gives a very famous line. There is always chance of an accident. So the royal road of regulation is there. At the same time, if one becomes attached to the regulation, then there is an accident. One will get stuck there. You know, one will be a niyamagraha. You know, that's the term used. So although they may be very carefully maintained, no one can guarantee that there will be no danger even on the safest road. So that attachment mentality, the enjoyment mentality is very strong in the jiva's consciousness. So it should be very carefully engaged for what it really needs to keep the mind calm so that one can continue the practice of Krishna consciousness. At the same time, one should guard that one doesn't become attached to that regulated sense enjoyment. You see here, therefore, in spite of regulated sense enjoyment, there is every chance of falling down. Therefore, any attachment for regulated sense enjoyment must also be avoided by all means. you know. So even the regulations also, one should be very careful that they don't get attached to them. What one should attachment should be for is Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada little below describes attachment to Krishna detaches one from all sense activities. So there is the what it essentially says is this, that to regulate from attachment or aversion, the extremes, there is rules given. One marches ahead with following those rules, but at the same time, one should not become attached to the rules, forgetting the purpose. So one should not falsely think that, okay, this rule, this level of rule which is given, the concessions which are given to help me, you know, to accommodate me, to help me practice Krishna consciousness, they are not themselves the final. There is something ahead. So I should march ahead. I should understand the purpose and continue ahead. So that's the essential meaning of this purport. Even the regulated sense enjoyment also, one should be careful to not get attached to them. That's the point. And next purport, next shloka, Lord says that it is better, O Arjuna, it is better, even if you're failing in following your duty, it is better that you perform your duty. Do not I for someone else's duty. So let's read that shloka, very famous, often discussed or charcha. Shreyan swadharmo viguna paradharmat svanushtita swadharme nithanam shreya paradharmo bhayavaha. Please read.
It is far better to discharge one's prescribed duties even though faultily than others' duties perfectly. Restriction in the course of performing one's own duty is better than engaging in another's duties, for to follow another's path is dangerous.
Hare Krishna. So Lord is kind of giving a clear dictation here. He's telling, you better follow your duty. Even if you think this duty is too painful for me, I'm not able to properly follow. Even if you fail at the right place, than thinking to that I will succeed, but it's not your place. Better you understand your place, your position, and try to execute it sincerely. Even if you fail, there is always a promotion in the eternal path. So this is very interesting. Shreyan, that's the Shreya, Swadharma Vigunaha, even if you're not able to do properly, Vigunaha, then Paradharmat Svanushtitat, even if you think you can do others' duty very nicely, still do not try. Swadharme Nidhanam Shreya. Nidhanam, you know, you understand what's the word Nidhanam mean? Destruction. So destruction in the course of performing one's own duty is better than engaging in another's duty. Paradharma, bhayavaha, because that's very dangerous to do like that. You know. So what Lord essentially tells is, Arjuna, you better fight. Even if you fail, you fail as being a kshatriya. Do not try to artificially become a renunciant, a karma sannyasi. So Lord is finally telling this comment here. Prabhupada tells some nice lines in the purport. One should discharge his prescribed duties in full Krishna consciousness than prescribed for others. Materially prescribed duties are duties told according to one's psychophysical condition. Do you know this word? Psychophysical condition. So tell me, what is this dharma? Prescribed.
Swabhava.
Is it vasana, sir?
Varnashrama.
Swabhava.
Yes, that's the what is referred. Under the spell of modes of material nature. But spiritual duties are ordered as per spiritual master for the service of Krishna. Whether material or spiritual, one should stick to his prescribed duties even up to death, rather than imitate another's prescribed duties. you know, essentially what guru orders for one is more important than, oh, maybe that is good. No, that instruction which guru gave is good. Of course, Prabhupada has given his instructions in the books for everyone as a generic instructions. We should take them and follow. And what guru tells one personally, that is more important also. That's swadharma for that devotee. So Prabhupada little below says, when one is under the spell of modes of material nature, one should follow the rules for that situation and not imitate others. Example, a Brahmana is in goodness, he is usually non-violent. But a Kshatriya is in passion, he is allowed to be violent. So for a Kshatriya, it is important to follow the rule of violence to keep up the dharma or the, you know, the law and order than imitate a Brahmana. So here, if we carefully see, what was Arjuna trying to be? He was trying to avoid the battle. So Kshatriya should not falsely act as Brahmana, imitating like that. So everyone has to cleanse his heart by the gradual process, not abruptly. But when one transcends the modes, this is a higher stage. If one transcends the modes of material nature, then one can act according to the orders of spiritual master. He can do anything and everything. See, this is a very higher stage. When one has transcended the modes, working in the modes means according to Varna and Ashrama. But transcending happens only when in pure Krishna consciousness. In that stage, Kshatriya may act as Brahmana, Brahmana may act as Kshatriya. So Prabhupada gives two examples in that regard, Parashurama and Vishwamitra, who actually, because of their very transcendental position, they could move from one position to the another position in the, you know, Varnashrama. So little below, Prabhupada says, being transcendentally situated, they could do so. But as long as one is on the material platform, he must perform his duties according to modes. At the same time, there should be Krishna consciousness always. He must have a full sense of Krishna consciousness. So essentially, just to summarize this discussion on the Swadharma, acting according to the modes. So one should try, what Lord is telling here is, perform one's duties, material and spiritual. So it is better to perform one's duties even if not perfectly, not able to succeed, but still one should perform one's duties as much as possible and not endeavor to perform someone else's duties, even if you think it is very easy, it is very lucrative, it's very rewarding, but still one should not endeavor for that. Maybe at this point, I would like to ask, usually why do people think that others' duties are more better? Why does that thought come? What is that thinking behind? Envy. Yes?
Because of envy. We being envy or we being jealous.
Okay, because of envy. Anything more?
Dissatisfaction. Okay. Yeah.
Grass is greener on the other side.
Grass is greener on the other side.
Okay, grass is greener on the other side. Okay, yes.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, to achieve the same results as others, Prabhuji. They're attracted to that.
Yes, to attain the rewards, say some fame, position, the successes which the other person has got, you know.
Yeah.
So
they think what others are doing is much faster and faster approach.
yes. So, but at the same, yes, thank you. Many, many good answers in this. But actually, if we do like that, the danger is we become very whimsical. Whatever we like, we choose. Oh, this is something which I should do. This looks to me my swadharma. I can do it expertly. And we jump to that. And after some time, maybe we think something else is better. So we leave that and we jump somewhere else. So what is happening? There is a whimsical nature which is being more and more fed. So one doesn't steady oneself in performance of one's duties. And secondly, we don't know what is the field of action in the other place. We just see, as someone told, greener on the other side. We don't know what is the sacrifice one has to do, what is the necessary qualities one has to develop, prerequisites one has to develop. All that we don't understand. And if we keep changing like that, then another thing which will happen is there will be people who will be doing what they want to do. what they choose to do. And that will cause social disruption. There will not be any structure in the society. And there will not be a framework of proper models, examples, which people can follow. So that will cause a social disruption also. So for many reasons, one can discuss about this more, that it is better to practice one's own duties than imitate others' duties. So Lord essentially completes the instruction of Karma Yoga there, you know. Yeah. Yes, someone had a question.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I had a question.
Yes.
In spiritual life, it's very easy. We can just follow spiritual master's orders and believe that that is our Swadharma, Prabhuji. But in material world, it's very hard to find out. Even if we want to follow Swadharma, how to find that what is my Swadharma,
Prabhuji? Yes, yes. We discussed about it little. The emphasis in practice of devotional service is to follow the orders of Guru. And earlier, the Gurus would give the orders according to one Swabhava, Swadharma. But nonetheless, following the orders are more important. The Guru's instructions are more important. Now, how does one find one's Swabhava or align with one's Swabhava so that one can find some stability, some peace in life? So the very practice of Krishna consciousness, very nicely if one does, it will elevate one to goodness, sattva guna. And by that position of goodness, one will understand what is one's swabhava little by little, little by little. You know, Prabhupada made that statement in Nectar of Instruction, introduction, I think, or preface. One should try to come to the mode of goodness. And once one attains the mode of goodness, what needs to be done future, it becomes revealed to him very naturally. I'm just paraphrasing that word. You may remember Nectar of Instruction preface. So living a lifestyle of goodness is very important to understand one's Swabhava. That's the first aspect. Second, one should have some guide who can see and monitor and tell us, this seems where you can be more naturally situated. You can do it, this duties, without getting materially infatuated. You put your best here, you know. So one can, if one has such a kind of guide, that's one's great fortunate position. You know, that is very nice. That's why in the Vedic times, the guru would be there in the Gurukula. He would monitor that boy or the child. And he would advise, yeah, this boy's guna is like this, Swabhava is like this. That's how Swabhava was found. Nonetheless, by one's honest introspection, one can find. By superior guidance and observation, one can find. By practice of sincere Krishna consciousness, one can find also. You know, because that naturally rewards that. So as much as possible, we try to align. As I was also telling, in Kali Yuga, there are natures which are mixed. You know, it's not that one is Brahminical, Kshatriya. In one personality, we'll see many, many things. You know, something beyond Varna and Ashram also, we will see so much of impurity and many things. So what we do, whatever is Pradhanya, predominant, we try to engage in that as much as possible. And that is everyone has that freedom. Krishna consciousness provides innumerable engagements. So one should engage according to that and offer one's best to Krishna in that manner. So there are some of the guidelines I have heard and I'm trying to practice also. Is that helpful to some extent?
Yes, Prabhuji. I have a small child question to that.
Okay.
Is it natural for us to do our Swadharma, Prabhuji, when we know that what we are doing is not, we are not becoming successful in it? Is it fair to, despite all the honest efforts and everything, is it fair to think that maybe, you know, I'm not built for this, this is not my Swabhava or Swadharma? Is it fair?
Yeah. So how does one know that this is one Swabhava? By one's practice, he will understand that he likes to do it. And he can do it repeatedly. He can go on doing it. you know, and he finds happy doing it, you know. So there are so many simple symptoms one can find, and one does it without getting infatuated. Suppose when one does others' duties, as we were just seeing, usually the motive is maybe I will get rewards, recognitions, or some facilities or things like this. So that means that is not one's swabhava, you know. But when one practices very naturally, you know, then that is his swabhava. At the same time, as I was telling, the distinguishment between vasanas and swabhava. In the conditioned stage, we are afflicted by vasanas, which have to be purified. Only when that purification happens, then we can see what is actual swabhava. You know, so it takes time. It is not something so easily said. It's not easily done as it is said. So the point is, the steady practice of Krishna consciousness under some superior guidance will help one to engage in that swabhava properly, you know, as much as possible. Is that okay?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you,
Prabhuji.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Can I ask the question, Prabhuji? Okay.
Yes, yes.
Okay. There is always a confusion for me, Prabhuji, on these three modes we have, right? Okay. The three modes are generated four ashramas. Okay. Sattva, Tamo, Rajo generated four ashramas. And now... Okay, maybe when we started Krishna consciousness, maybe we have highest level of tamo, okay, and then some level of lazo, and then very low level of sattvaguna. And then we continue practicing, these modes continue changing. So before that, you are doing a type of task, okay, a type of work, okay, along practicing Krishna consciousness. Now, when we are continue our journey and these changes, so when these changes, definitely, okay, you tend to do something else than what you were doing few years back. So, but Krishna is always saying that you stick to your swabhava. You stick to your guna, he's saying. So does it mean that, like, yes, when these three gunas are changing, when what you are doing, when what interest are changing, right? Obviously, your interest also will change because those three gunas continue changing. So does it gives a indication to us by Krishna and Prabhupada saying that, okay, you can pick up something else, something different, because your three gunas started changing. Is that acceptable? Yes.
Okay, good. See, when we receive the instruction of Guru, that is beyond the modes of material nature. That's why Guru Mukha Padma Vakya, it is told. Padma means it is not touched by the modes. Padma, lotus, is not touched by the lotus leaf, is not touched by the water. Now, when we are practicing, you know, as we want to do, then we are surely touched by modes. And when we practice devotional service, there is purification which is happening. That purification means that the Raja and Tama are getting destroyed. We are getting purified from that tada rajas tamo bhava kama lobha dayaschaye. Essentially, they are the disturbing elements in devotional service. So they are getting destroyed. And one is becoming more and more fixed in goodness. Stitam sattve prasidati. You may have remembered these words. So, so sattva is becoming more and more and more prominent. And when that sattva becomes very steady and pure, that is nothing but pure Krishna consciousness. Shuddha sattva, is it not? So when we are practicing devotional service, what is happening? We have gained from many past lives. Okay. And that is not quick to be changed. And that is not necessary also in that sense, quick to be changed. As we earlier saw, prakriti or swabhava is something which could be harmonized in Krishna consciousness. Okay, it could be harmonized in Krishna consciousness. It doesn't change so quickly. As one changes from vasanas, vasanas get purified. At the same time, the swabhavas could be very nicely engaged in Krishna consciousness. What is happening is the swabhava is getting purified. Say a Vaishya who is practicing, who had the predominant modes of Tama and Raja, because he has two modes. He was earlier doing his activities in Raja and Tama majorly. But now he has become a devotee. he sees that his actions, his business, whatever he does, he sees it as belonging to Krishna, offers the results to Krishna. So what is happening here? The sattva element is increasing. He is not so much fixed on the results. So Raja and Tama, they are making a person always think about future or past. So sattva makes one think in the present. So when a karma yogi is practicing, he is actually really being in the present because he doesn't worry about the results or he doesn't lament about the past. So karma yogi really being in the present, you know. So Vaishya, I'm just telling here in that sense, the word I'm using, the Vaishya, but we should not call a devotee as a Vaishya like that. But one who has that mentality, when he's practicing devotional service, he can render that Vaishya vritti in a very pure manner. Or a Shudra vritti in a very pure manner. It's not that he has to change from, okay, you know, Vaishya to Kshatriya, Kshatriya to Brahmana, you know. It's not necessary. And one can go back to supreme spiritual world from any Varna or Ashrama. We have seen so many examples. So going to Shuddha Sattva is not necessarily that you come to a Brahmana stage and then from there you get a launch pad or like that. That is the only good. No, not really like that. See, the modes are, you know, it's like Lord says, they intertwine into multiple, there are combinations of it. You know, even in the Raja, you can see there are again three modes coming inside, Sattva, Raja, Tama. So they are, you know, combining in different permutations, combinations like that. So it is not as easy as we consider. But point I am saying is that by practice of Krishna consciousness, one can render Swabhava Vrittis very purely for pleasure of Krishna. Very purely for pleasure of Krishna. And that is elevating one directly to spiritual world. You know, so there are, in, we can see this in Dwaraka, Mathura, or, you know, Vrindavan. People performing their duties. They have their Swabhavas, like, you know, Ugrasena, he's the king. And the Gopas are the Vaishyas. They are, you know, simple cowherd men like that. There are Brahmanas, Pandavas are Kshatriyas. They are pure devotees. They are performing their Swabhava, but for pleasure of Krishna. Mm. And that is taking them, elevating them to spiritual world. So one performs one's Swabhava, one purifies that Swabhava very nicely for pleasure of Krishna. That is the goal of engaging in Krishna consciousness. In this engagement of Swabhava properly. Hope this addresses to some extent. Actually, this modes of nature discussion comes more elaborately in 14th chapter. So we could discuss there, you know. That is better.
So, okay, Prabhu, I understood. Just to summarize my understanding, we have to differentiate between spiritually what you're doing with the order of Guru versus the vritti what you're doing. You have to differentiate that. Okay, and then carry on whatever you have. That is what you are trying to say, correct?
Yeah. So, for example,
if somebody is in Shuddha Vritti or Vaishya Vritti, he needs to continue over there. It doesn't mean that he needs to come to another Kshatriya Vritti or Brahman Vritti. Doesn't need to be there at all.
There is no need. That's why Lord is telling it. Shriyan Svatharma. Like that also.
Okay.
So one just statement I will tell, by practice of devotional service, one purifies one's Swabhava. One doesn't necessarily need to move from one Swabhava to other as a development of devotional service. If the order of Guru is there, the devotee will do. But after some time, he will naturally come to his Swabhava and perform for pleasure of Krishna.
Got it. Understood. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. This gave some clarity, actually. This was a long pending question for me. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. We are going till 8:30 today. I think it was informed. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yes, any last question?
Hare Krishna, okay. Prabhuji.
Yes, Vivek Prabhuji.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Prabhuji, I was just basically a little not clear. Although we are discussing the Niskam Karma Yoga, however, it looks like there is a strong sense of bhakti, right, in the purport.
Prabhupada is right, pushing right. So like when we say right, one should become situated on the platform of Krishna consciousness, right? Because as per my understanding, as you explained, Niskam Karma Yoga is dominated by I, right? It's all centered towards I. And when we talk about Bhakti Yoga, that's where, right, we put Krishna in the center, right? But whenever Prabhupada is mentioning here that one should become situated on the platform of Krishna consciousness, or one should therefore discharge their prescribed duties in full Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada is mentioning, whether he is right mentioning Bhakti Yoga here, or it is, I mean, say that's the ultimate goal, even if you're performing in Niskam Karma Yoga, but that is what one has to go. So maybe that is what I understood, Prabhuji. Maybe you can clear that.
Yeah, you're right. So Prabhupada is giving the ultimate conclusion of Bhakti Yoga in the very beginning purports itself. We had discussed this, that Prabhupada is actually Nishkama Karma Yoga matures into Jnana, then into Ashtanga, then, you know, there is Bhakti, which comes later, which will come much later in the Bhagavad Gita. But nonetheless, Prabhupada tells the devotional service as it refers in the Nishkama Karma Yoga part. Because as earlier we saw, Bhakti Yoga also has the element of Nishkama Karma Yoga. And Bhakti Yoga also has the element of Jnana Yoga. Ashtanga Yoga means all yogas could be seen in Bhakti Yoga. You know, say in Bhakti Yoga, we are not attached to the results. Are we not? So when we are studying these purports, when Prabhupada is telling, he is telling that element of Bhakti Yoga. Is it not? So in that sense, we should see it.
Got it. So whenever Prabhupada is mentioning Krishna consciousness, he's definitely referring Bhakti Yoga here.
Yeah, Bhakti. There is no doubt. That's very clear. Yeah.
Okay. All right, Prabhuji. Thank you. Thank you so much for the clarification.
Actually, there is one final chart I will describe about it a little later, about different yoga paths and how Bhakti Yoga very seamlessly travels through all the paths. What are the essential elements which are there, you know, in Bhakti Yoga like that. Maybe it will become clearer there. I want to complete all the six, and at the end we will discuss that one small last slide there. Theek hai. So now we will go to the next section of third chapter, very important section of third chapter, which is addressing a very important topic of a possible impediment in practice of Nishkama Karma Yoga. One of the greatest impediment in practice of Nishkama Karma Yoga. The very word Nishkama means one doesn't have Kama for the results. So that means the Kama is the natural impediment for a Nishkama Karma Yogi. One has to, you know, keep it at bay. one should take care that one doesn't come under the Kama. And that Kama is being discussed, how to address it, how to deal with it in this last section of third chapter. So we have covered, I'll just quickly show that slide. Yeah. Are you seeing this 36 to 43? Overcome lust, the main obstacle on the path of Nishkama Karma Yoga. That's the discussion. So Lord Krishna, after telling the Karma Yoga discussion, he pauses. After this 35th shloka, he stops. Now Arjuna, he clearly gets a question. Oh Lord, sometimes people, even having the knowledge of, yes, I am different from the body, I should offer the results, this doesn't belong to me, I should not be attached to the results, you know, all this, still one does something which is against one's desire. Is the samskaras making him act? No, they are not something conscious. Or is the Paramatma forcing him to act? No, Paramatma will never force a jiva to act. He only sanctions the desires. So what is making him act like this? That's the question of Arjuna in 36. So let us see that. Arjuna uvacha. अथ केन प्रयुक्तो यम पापं चरति पुरुष अनिच्छन्नपि वार्ष्णेय बलादिव नियोजितः.
Arjuna said, O descendant of Rishni, by what is one impelled to sinful acts, even unwillingly, as if engaged by force?
As if engaged by force, yeah. So you see the carefully the words. Atha kena prayuktoyam, who is engaging this person, this jiva, in papam charati, in the papam. Sometimes we don't have a desire before engaging in the papa to engage in the papa, but something happens and one is forced to do it. Anichchan api varshne. Anichchan means he doesn't have a desire. He did not plan it or like that. But it happens. It as if it's baladiva niyojita. One is forced to engage. Why is this happening? What is making him it happen? That's the question of Arjuna. Now this question is very, very relevant because even the people who don't accept Krishna, who are not theists or believers of God, they will also accept this fact. The psychologists, they will surely accept this fact. There are so many famous stars of the society who committed mistakes repeatedly. And when they were interviewed, why you did that, you know, you suffered, every time you did the mistake, you suffered. Why you did that, then they have clearly admitted something has forced me to have work like this. So everyone understands that there is some force within which acts sometimes against one's good interest. So that is very well admitted fact. So Arjuna is asking this question. Baladiva niyojita. So Prabhupada says here, Arjuna's question to Krishna is very sanguine. Sanguine means very important, very noble, very optimistic also. As to the perverted nature of the living entities. So Prabhupada told, in contact with material nature, the jiva acts in many sinful ways without hesitation and sometimes even against his will. Although living entity sometimes does not want to act in sin, he is forced to act. So sinful actions are not compelled by super soul, but are some other cause. What is that cause? That's the Arjuna's question. Now, Lord clearly comes to the point. He tells the answer in the next book. Someone else would read translations from next shloka? Can any other devotee?
Yes, Prabhuji. Prabhuji can read.
Okay, Prasad Prabhu can read.
Okay.
So let's chant the shlokas. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Kama Esha, Krodha Esha, रजोगुणसमुद्भव महाशनो महापाप्मा विध्येनं इह वैरिणम्. Yes.
Yes, Prabhu, translation. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, it is lust only, Arjuna, which is born of contact with the material mode of passion and later transformed into wrath, and which is all devouring sinful enemy of this world.
See, this very Lord directly tells, which is this? The Vairi who is acting against you, Arjuna, are not the people in front only. There is someone who is sitting within. He is the Vairi. Vairi means enemy. So he is Kama, who later becomes Krodha. And he is originally born from Rajoguna, Rajoguna Samudbhava. So we all know that lust, Kama, what it means is intense desire for enjoyment, selfish enjoyment. It is not just limited to, you know, the enjoyment between male and female. It is something much deeper. It means desire for any sense object. Intense desire for sense object, sense gratification, the enjoyment mentality, that is Kama. And that's the greatest enemy for Nishkama Karma Yoga practice. So Lord is telling here two interesting, in fact, three. So Kama is Mahashana. Can someone tell the translation, the word to word meaning? Mahashana. Ashana, Mahashana. What's the meaning? Mahashana. Ashana means to eat. Mahasana means to eat everything or devour, you know, pura, there is nothing left out. That's called Mahasana, you know, that the great demon, he eats everything, he leaves nothing. In fact, when a person is afflicted,
voracious, Prabhuji.
Voracious, yeah, voracious. So he doesn't leave anything sacred. Everything is taken away when a person is afflicted by lust. He doesn't care what he's doing, what he should behave, how he should behave. He is driven off from everything. He is stripped off from everything. That is called Mahashana. He loses all the good things. Whatever good he had gained, he'll lose it. That's Mahashana. And Mahapapma, nothing sacred remains. When a person too much afflicted by lust, Mahapapma. There are so many strange expressions of lust which are very, very sinful. You know, lust is not only dangerous, it's also very treacherous. That was the famous statement. Treacherous. Treacherous means it takes many, many forms. Means it can cheat. It's not that you can easily find out, okay, this is how lust is. No. Lust can take many, many forms. Just like for Bharata, Maharaj, the deer, it came. And that's how he fell into trap. Is it not? For a Vishwamitra, it came in many, many ways. In the beginning as Menaka, then there was another Apsara, then there was a Trishanku's, you know, challenge. Many, many ways. So it's treacherous. It's not just dangerous. It's called here Vairi, enemy. If an enemy, if he is understood that he is enemy, this is how he looks. It's very easy. You can always guard against. But if one is treacherous, treacherous means one disguises in many ways. One who is expert in disguises, it's very difficult. You can cheat. And more importantly, this enemy is within. He's inside. Internal enemies are far more dangerous than externals. They can cause much greater damage. So here Lord is addressing, Kama is that great Vairi, O Arjuna. Not just the people in front of you. They are to be killed as a matter of your duty. But guard against this Vairi, which is Kama. Which later becomes Krodha and goes into the mode of ignorance. Kama is born of passion, but Krodha is going into ignorance. So, and it will become the greatest devouring. Everything, whatever good you have gained, will be eaten up. And it will put you into Mahapapa. So understand this. So Prabhupada tells very interestingly in the purport the understanding of how lust originally comes. Everything has its origin in the Supreme only. So the love which the Jiva has towards Supreme Lord, which is very pure, that becomes transformed or perverted into lust. Just as milk becomes a yogurt. So Prabhupada gives that example, how love transforms into lust as milk gets transformed into yogurt. And little below, Prabhupada says how there are different modes, like Kama is born of passion, then it gets degenerated into Krodha, which is ignorance. So one should save oneself by elevating to goodness. So a little, in the last section, Prabhupada says, origin of lust is also in Supreme. Therefore, lust is transformed into love for Supreme or transformed into Krishna consciousness, that is desiring everything for Krishna. Then both lust and wrath could be spiritualized. Wrath means intense anger. That's the word we used here. What is the example? Hanuman. Hanuman used his anger, great anger in service of Lord. And Krishna is telling Arjuna, you also use your anger in service of Lord, in service of Supreme. So Lord Prabhupada is hinting here at how one should protect oneself, engage oneself with this lust, how one should transform it in positive manner. So Lord will now explain in the sequence of shlokas that how lust becomes an impediment. What lust does, how it works, what is its modus operandi, what are the ways of its function in the next few shlokas. 38. Dhumena vriyate vahmir yatha darsho malena cha yathol bena vrito garbhas tata tene dama vritam. Read.
Yes, Prabhu. Okay. As fire is covered by smoke, as mirror is covered by dust, or as the embryo, is covered by the womb, the living entity is similarly covered by different degrees of this lust.
One of the very important functions of lust is it covers. It covers. What it covers? It covers one's real knowledge. Late in the next shloka comes avritam jnanam etena. The Lord will tell that next. So what is this covering which is talked here? How do we understand this covering? So Lord is giving three examples. So the first example Lord gives, which is the first degree of covering by lust, is fire covered by smoke. Dhume na priyate vahnir. Dhuma means smoke. So when we see, at least I remember when I went to my grandmother's place, the chula, the ole, we used to have that pipe. Sometimes I would go and try to blow that and make the fire come. If one knows properly how to blow, then the smoke will go away, but the fire will nicely burn. It will come out nicely. So Prabhupada compares that to human life. In human life also there is lust, but by proper cultivation of consciousness, then the fire could be very nicely, productively seen. Fire covered by smoke. If one doesn't know, once I was blowing, instead of blowing, I sucked the air. I sucked that smoke and I was coughing for a long time. So if one knows that proper blowing, that is proper practice of spiritual life, Krishna consciousness, can make that real knowledge of fire very evident. Krishna consciousness. That's the first one. So humans have a greater degree, greater chance to elevate from lust. Purify the Krishna. Now, second covering. What's the second one? Can you see it and spot? Very easy. Mirror covered by dust. Mirror covered by dust. So after long duration of not using the mirror, so much of dust accumulates on it. Sometimes it's so much dust that we cannot even recognize that there is a mirror here. The dust, the dirt becomes so accumulated, you have to scrub it. You have to really clean it hard to understand it was a mirror. And then one can understand, this is an image here. I can see my reflection here. And that is compared to animal life. In animal life, the covering is so much that the animals are very naturally, instinctively acting for according to the lust. You cannot dictate some self-control to them. Very hardly they can, is it not? So, but at the same time, they can to some extent awaken it. There are some examples, very rare examples of animals who took to spiritual life, So that requires special mercy, surely. That's the second covering. Now, third covering, very interesting. Embryo covered by the womb. The living, embryo is covered by the womb. So the covering, the garbha, which has covered the shishu, ulbeena, what is the used here? Yatholbeena avrata garbha. Garbha is the embryo. So embryo is covered by the womb. So one cannot understand that there is a living being inside the womb. It cannot be seen. Hardly one can understand that, there is a living being inside. So like that, there are living beings like trees, which hardly manifest symptoms of consciousness. There is only some growth one can see after a long period of observation. But there is not much symptoms of consciousness. Just like some stone, they are just staying at one place. They are achara. They are just standing there, and they cannot exhibit much sentiments, reciprocate, respond. So that is the covering, the deeper covering of lust. So the 3 degrees are mentioned here. First one, fire covered by smoke. That is compared to human consciousness. Second one, mirror covered by dust. That is compared to
animal consciousness.
Animal consciousness. And the third one is embryo covered by the womb, which is compared to, yes? Tree consciousness. I like that. So here, Lord has clearly told these 3 levels of covering. Prabhupada explains that in the purport. Now, what happens by that covering? That's explained in next shloka. Avritam jnanametena jnanino nitya vairina kamarupena kaunteya dushpurena analena cha. Read.
Yes, okay. Thus, the wise living entity's pure consciousness becomes covered by his eternal enemy in the form of lust, which is never satisfied and which burns like fire.
So one very important quality here, it is covering. The pure consciousness is covered. The real knowledge is covered. Another interesting quality of lust is it is never satisfied. The word used is dushpurena. Dushpurena and analena. How much ever you provide it, it will never become satisfied. That's the nature of lust. So there are so many pastimes in Srimad Bhagavatam about this. One very famous pastime I recollect is Yayati. Yayati, he at the end, the essential instruction in that pastime actually is that how much ever one is enjoying in the material world, even according to Vedic scriptures, you know, Yayati was leading a very pious religious life. And he was enjoying sense gratification for a long, long time. He, in fact, gained youth from his son, is it not? He underwent a curse and later gained the youth from one of his sons. He enjoyed for thousands of years. But at the end, he says, there is a very nice shlokas in Srimad Bhagavatam about it. Yayati is confessing. He's in front of his wife that this lust I fell prey to and it could never be satisfied. Analena, like a fire. Can you satisfy fire by putting some ghee or some kerosene or petrol like that? Never. So by engagement of senses according to lust, one can never satisfy lust. You can never satisfy lust. So it is explained like this. So Prabhupada tells in the purport, the Manusmriti says, lust cannot be satisfied by any amount of sense enjoyment. In the material world is called as maithunya agar, shackles of sex life. Usually criminals are kept within bars. Similarly, the criminals who are disobedient to the laws of the Lord are shackled by sex life. Nowadays, and of course, Prabhupada says, advanced of material civilization on the basis of sense gratification means increasing the duration of material existence of living entity. Nowadays, it has become a standard of progress, that how much one expresses one's lust. It is such a perversion, we can see that. And that becomes very, very dangerous, you know, living in such a civilization, practicing devotional service. Prabhupada says one another important quality here. The lust is a vairi. It is an enemy because enemy gives suffering. How lust gives suffering? Lust, when a sense is come in touch with sense object, there is an experience of happiness. So how is that suffering? Prabhupada answers it. This lust is the symbol of ignorance by which living entity is kept within material world. while one enjoys sense gratification, it may be that there is some feeling of happiness. But actually, that so-called feeling of happiness is the ultimate enemy of the sense enjoyer. A very famous statement, the so-called feeling of happiness is the ultimate enemy of sense enjoyer. See, we can just take one small example. The fish, when the fish is caught, on the hook, there is a worm. And the fishing, whoever is fishing, he lets the fish taste the worm for some time. So there is some feeling of happiness, you know, he's feeling that happiness. He's thinking, he's becoming confident. Yes, yes, I can enjoy like that. But after some time, when he goes deep within, he is pulled out. his life is actually gone. So the point is, when one engages in according to lust, what is one making? One's identification with the matter becomes very, very strong. Very strong. And that identification afterwards make him repeatedly perform material activities, which are actually ignorance. And that will impel one to act in sin. Mahapapma. We saw that in the earlier shloka. And that sin will give suffering. When a person lands up in lust, you know, and the lust attacks him, then he doesn't care what he wants to do. He will forego everything. Like, you know, we see Ajamila. He contemplated on the sense objects. He did not even come in touch with the sense object. He contemplated, and from there, it went on to take him into such a papa. Now, we usually say this, you know, between Visha and Vishaya. Visha means poison, and Vishaya means sense object. Between Visha and Vishaya, Vishaya is more dangerous. You have heard this, maybe many of you might have heard it. Can anyone tell why? Can you explain if you have heard it? Between Visha means something which kills.
Visha is only for one birth. Vishaya could lead so many births actually.
Okay, Vishaya could lead to so many births. Okay, he may be repeatedly by dying.
Yeah, by Visha may be spoiling only these births. And this Vishaya birth, is triggering vasanas, and it's all like unlimited.
Correct, very good. Any other answer? Visha and Vishaya? Any other answer?
We can have different kinds of pains.
Yes, please continue. Different, what we can have different?
Different kinds of pains in Visha. But in Visha, only one time we can take the pain. But in Visha, we can take different stages of pains.
Okay, it repeatedly gives suffering. The pain is repeated, not just once. Okay, thank you. Yes, there was one more answer. Yes.
Object sense of objects for sense enjoyment.
Objects of sense enjoyment. Can you repeat? What?
Different objects for sense enjoyment.
Okay. The Vishaya could be multiple forms, different. Yes. Another thing I heard, Visha, you have to take into your system to affect. Say you eat or you put it into your blood. Or some way you smell, something like that. And that's how it kills the person. But Vishaya is something which even by contemplation, one can be affected. Like Ajamila, we saw this line of shlokas, Dhyayato Vishayan Punsa Sangasteshu Pajayate, the 8 steps of fall, which we saw. How to be careful in the second chapter. So how does it start? Dhyayata. Dhyayata means contemplation. So there is no contact with the sense object yet. Vishaya is still just contemplated on the mind, and still it is causing such a dangerous effect. So that is the danger. That's the extent of danger of Vishaya. So Lord says that it is avritam nanametena. And how it becomes insatiable, like fire. Yeah. Now, there are a few more shlokas in this chapter. I thought we will complete it. we will do it in the next session, and we will complete and take to the fourth chapter. So next section will be how to conquer the lust, and Lord will explain the hierarchy of the senses. So today we saw starting from 30, the Karma Sara, Mayi Sarvani Karmani verse. And then we saw how Karma Yoga elevates a person, and how what reward he gets, what loss he attains if he doesn't practice Karma Yoga properly. And then we saw about Swadharma, that concept which Lord explains, perform one's duties even though faultily, than try for someone else's duties. And then just now we started this theme of how lust is one of the greatest obstacles in practicing Nishkama Karma Yoga, and what is the nature of lust we saw today. Can anyone recollect what's the nature of lust? 2-3 points about it. What's the nature of lust? How it impedes Nishkama Karma Yogi or a devotee?
It completely covers our consciousness.
Okay, it's avrita, it covers. That's the one thing. We saw three types of covering there. Yeah, that was
human consciousness, animal consciousness, and tree consciousness.
Animal conscious and tree conscious. Yes. Any other way it impedes, it obstructs?
It is never satisfied.
It's never satisfied.
Always. Fire go up, actually. It will not come down.
Transforms into wrath.
Yes, last input. Can you repeat, Mataji?
Transforms
into wrath. That's also one important feature of lust. If it's satisfied, then it becomes greed, which is dangerous. If it's not satisfied, it becomes anger, which is more dangerous. So there is always, whether you satisfy, try to satisfy, or even if you are not able to satisfy, there is always a negative consequence in that sense. Okay, so from the next few shlokas, we will see Lord's instructions on how to tackle with this enemy of lust, who is seated within, who is treacherous, who is dangerous, how to deal with him, the enemy. So Arjuna has to deal with the more important enemy within than just someone in front. So we will see that in the next session. Thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dandavat.